I want to start with saying how much of an honor it is to be around so many veterans. I look in the audience and I see amazing people, and I want to thank you for your service and nag you to make sure your stories are written down. Today we have a particular honor, General John Alison. It would be difficult for me to tell you what he didn't do. In the beginning, before we were engaged in World War II, Johnny went over with the P-40s to the British to break them into our airplanes. He ended up being in Moscow as our liaison on Lend-Lease. When Pearl Harbor was attacked, he went over to Burma. He flew with Tex Hill. In fact, I think he was roommates with Tex Hill, and I bet those are really good stories. He came back to the States. He thought he was going to go over to Europe with a new flight of fighters with the 8th Air Force. They pulled him again. He is the father of special ops. He ended up taking British troops behind the Japanese lines in Burma. Now, if we really had a week or two, we could talk about all the stories. But I've kind of narrowed it down to a couple of stories, and I'm going to let him do the talking. The first story, Johnny, that I'm going to ask you about is you were called on to demonstrate the P-40 to Chenault. You started out at Mitchell Field. Will you tell us about that flight? I can tell you that Chenault said he's never seen somebody get more out of a P-40 than John Alison on that demonstration flight.
Well, I did a lot of things just simply because I was told to do them. And by people smarter than I, and we'll get to that in a minute, but because it's pretty easy to find them. I don't even know how to talk into the microphone. But anyway, early in the war, the world was kind of, the closet was kind of full for us. You can be very proud of your nation. We became the arsenal of democracy, and that is because some very fine people work awful hard to do it. I happened to be, at the time, I was in China with General Chenault, and I'd like to tell you the details of that, but it would take too long. But Chenault was a great patriot. But not only a great patriot, he was a great flyer himself, personally. He understood, and he understood the nature of fighter pilots. And he produced in China, at a time when we were losing battles all over the world, Chenault produced winners with his American volunteer group. And the ABG were just ordinary kids like you are now, except it was a long time ago. And we fought the Japanese, and simply because Chenault knew the strengths of our aircraft, and he knew the weaknesses of the Japanese aircraft, we were able to take advantage of Chenault's knowledge. And I don't know what the ratio was, but it was far more than a 1-to-1. We shot down several Japanese fighters for every one of us that was brought down. And as a result, the Japanese were slowed down at a time when we were just completely, the free world was disarmed. And we were so badly in need of war material. Actually, it's wonderful that America did respond, and America became the arsenal of democracy.
Quick question, Johnny. How did they end up with P-40s over in Burma?
Well,
who taught them?
The P-40s were the only thing we had to give them.
And why did Chenault pick that P-40? Somebody showed him how to fly it.
Well, Chenault knew things about the P-40 that we didn't know. He knew things that I didn't know.
I can't get this man to brag about. I can't get you to brag. I want you to tell him the story of that first demonstration flight in the P-40. Oh,
okay, I was at Mitchell Field, Long Island, just an ordinary junior birdman, I guess. And a phone call came in, and it said, take a P-40 and fly it to Bowling. And I said, what for? And they said, you're going to demonstrate it to the Chinese. And so I got in my P-40, I flew to Bowling, and I went up to the office of the commander of Bowling Air Force Base. And I said, here I am. And he said, well, why don't you go out and demonstrate the P-40? And I said, well, what do you want me to do? And they said, well, demonstrate it. I said, no, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to do some acrobatics? Or do you want me to just fly at high speed? And at that, I said, you know, we have lots of regulations now. Bowling Field is right in the Washington, D.C. municipal area. And to do acrobatics, I said, I can't do acrobatics. We have regulations against it. Well, the Curtis chief test pilot was there, and the Curtis vice president was there. The Curtis vice president said, well, can our test pilot fly the airplane? And I said, by all means, he can certainly fly it. I said, all you have to do is pick up the telephone, call Mitchell Field, and they'll say, okay. Well, the commander at Bowling, he didn't want to do that. Because actually, we were losing so many airplanes. We were losing pilots. And nobody wanted to take responsibility for that. So the commander of Bowling just began to hem and haw, and then all of a sudden he was fed up with it. He says, oh, Allison says, to hell with it, just go out and fly a demonstration. So those were my instructions. And the P-40 would really perform far better than anyone knew, because it had been arbitrarily limited to 980 horsepower for takeoff, and it was capable of far more. But they were afraid this was a whole new system, and they didn't want anything to break, and nobody wanted to take responsibility for it. So I got in, and I pushed it up to... Well, the chief engineer of the Allison Engine Company said, well, you were getting 14, probably close to 1,500 horsepower out of that engine. And it didn't detonate. It did it beautifully. And as a result, as I went down the runway at Bowling and headed into the wind, and as soon as I got to 980 horsepower, I went through all the stops. The old Allison really responded, and the airplane just took off. I didn't have to do anything spectacular, but just how quickly it got in the air and how it climbed, it even impressed me. I didn't know it would do that. And I did a few maneuvers at high speed. And one in particular, the inspection party was standing out in the middle of Bowling Field, and I put my wingtip right on them and opened the throttle and pulled the stick back and did a tighter turn than I'd ever done in the P-40, and it responded beautifully, and it was, I figured it would be spectacular, and it was. And then I landed right after that. I thought, I've about done enough. And it was kind of a cold, windy day, and the inspection party walked into the hangar, and as I taxied by them, I could tell by the smile on the face of the Curtis Wright salesman that they were quite pleased with the demonstration. And I got out of the airplane, and the Chinese were very excited. They came up excited and told Chino, he says, what we need is 100 of those airplanes. And Chino looked at the Chinese general right in that eye and said, no, that's not what you need. And he came over and tapped me on the chest. He says, you need 100 of those. And actually, that's what Chino was looking for. He recruited the volunteers the American, all of them were reserve officers. They volunteered to fight for Chinook. And that was the beginning of the Flying Tigers. And they had a remarkable record in our favor. It was just great.
We were talking yesterday, Johnny, about leadership and how you were talking about Granddad and how difficult it is to send men into battle, knowing that something may happen. You wrote an article about one of the young men in your command, a guy by the name of John Hampshire. The article was called The Death of a Fighter Pilot. Would you talk about that particular incident?
Right. Because we had lots of young, bright young Americans coming and going through the flying school and then getting into the Air Force. And one that came to my squadron was a boy by the name of John Hampshire from Grants Pass, Oregon. And he'd been a star football player. And he was just one of the most competitive boys I've ever known. And he was also very good. And his one ambition was to beat me. And every pilot that we recruited and came into our squadron had to first fight me because I wanted to know what the capabilities of the guy was. And so Hampshire, he was so anxious. And I fought every man, big ones and little ones. And so I fought Hampshire, and I fought him to a standstill, but he wasn't as easy. But he cheats. he cheated on our side. I had a rule that for these contests that everybody had to have full gas tanks because the weight, and particularly the weight in the rear tank behind the pilot, moved the center of gravity back. And in a dogfight, if you got the center of gravity too far behind, you spun out. And I'm sure Hampshire knew that. And I fought him, and it was very difficult. He came down, and I said to, Lieutenant Hampshire, you did a great job. You're a good fighter pilot, and I hope that you live through it. And then I turned to his crew chief, and I said, did he have full gas tanks? And his crew chief, with a very sheepish smile, kind of shook his head and said, no. And I said, well, I'm going to forgive you this time, Hampshire, because you're a guy who wants to win, and you've got all the capabilities, and I'm going to need you. And he was he wanted to be the greatest ace of World War II, and he was well on the way when the Japanese killed him. And
talk about that. Talk about the mission where you lost John Hampshire. The death of the fighter pilot, when you sent the doctor out.
When I sent the...
Doctor.
The doctor. We just had a lot of improvising to do. I had this really a big fight. We were really exciting. And it was two phases. The first phase... We finished, and Hampshire had been in. He pulled up alongside, and he said to me, "How many did you get?" And I said, "I didn't score a victory." I said, "I expended a lot of ammunition, but I said I'm not claiming anyone." How many did you get? And he says, "Well, I got two," and or maybe it was three. I don't know. But Hampshire was very good, and he was a great shot, and. So then we headed back to our own base, which was under attack by the Japanese, and we got in the fight again. And then we landed, but Hampshire wasn't with us. He'd gone down somewhere. And I called for him, and we sent a search crew out to look for him. But before we could find him, the Chinese army sent us a message saying, "American pilot, hit in stomach, guts running out, send doctor quick." Well, that was a very depressing message because John Hampshire was really going to be a champion for us. He was a champion. And We had really lost our best fighter pilot, and but the patriotism, the affection of guys who fight together, immediately the hands volunteered and said, "We'll go out and search for him." Now, we had very poor maps, if any, and now it's getting dark, and John somewhere wounded out in the boondocks, and we've got to find him. So our doctor, our medical doctor, not a pilot, not a warrior, said, "I volunteer, I'm going." And we only had, we had
P-43s.
we had derivatives of the P-40, the P-43, which had a baggage compartment big enough to put a man in. So our doctor, who was not a pilot, volunteered to go in the baggage compartment and have our fighter pilots fly him over the area where Hampshire had been known to go down, and the doctor was going to jump out, and because we knew Hampshire had been severely wounded, because the message the Chinese said, American pilot hit in the stomach, guts running out, and that really does a lot to you. So just at dark, we sent the airplanes out to try and find where Hampshire had gone. We knew generally where he'd gone down. And one of the pilots, by the name of Joe Griffith, was the pilot. And when he came, pretty soon, he's out of gas, and it's dark. And when you got lost at night over China, there are no electric lights. It's just a black mass of land, and almost a hopeless task. But as the pilot Griffin looked down, he saw a few flickering lights. There's no electricity, but these were tung oil lamps that illuminated a village. And he looked down. Joe was just ready to jump, and he looked down and he saw these flickering lights. Then all of a sudden, the around the night, a big fire. And so he said, "Well, the Chinese have set fire in this field and they want me to land." So he alerted the doctor to jump out. And as he went around, all of a sudden, the landscape just burst into flame. And he didn't know it, but what had happened, the Chinese heard this P-40 circling the, actually it was P-38, circling this their village, and they had a cache of 100 octave gasoline, and they opened the bung on a 50-gallon drum, and they rolled it down what had been an abandoned runway, and then they set the runway on fire. And with the dry field, it really burst into flame. It gave Griffin an opportunity to get oriented, and he landed the airplane, and the doctor was safe inside. But we still hadn't found Hampshire, and I'm sitting at base wondering, where in the world is my ace? And my I didn't have the courage to tell General Chenault that I had lost Hampshire, and that I now had lost another pilot and another airplane trying to find Hampshire. And I just said, "I'm going to wait it out, and I'll wait it out tomorrow, and then I will send a message out that I have lost two." two of my best pilots. And I waited until the next morning, and just when I had finished, I drafted a wire, making it as easy as I could on myself, because I felt that it was my fault, first of all, to let them go, and first to send them on the mission, and second, to let them go and try and find this wounded soldier. And this airplane has been out all night. It's out of gasoline, and Lord knows where they've been. It just couldn't have happened, and I couldn't imagine it. And the airplane touched down, taxied into where we were, where we had our airplanes parked. The baggage compartment flew open, and there was the doctor's head sticking out of the baggage compartment. And they'd used up the gasoline hours before. And I said, "Where in the hell have you been?" And Griffin said, told about getting ready. He was ready to jump when he saw these flickering lights, and he figured it was a Chinese village, and he wanted the Chinese to have a rescue team when he jumped out. And before they could, actually, they were ready to jump. Before they could go overboard, the gasoline began to burn, and Griffin said, "Well, the Chinese want me to land." And he landed in this burning field, which was an abandoned runway, and although we lost Hampshire.
I'm going to take you to another quick story before they cut our time off. If I'm not mistaken, you were the first American to fly a Zero. Would you tell us a story about flying the Zero?
Well, I was the first that I know of, but I don't think anyone else flew one, because the Zero shot down lots of Americans. I didn't even know this, but the telephone rang, and General Chino on the end of the phone, and he called me and he said, "We've captured a Japanese Zero, and I want you to go down and fly it out of the, it was down at an abandoned airfield. I want you to fly it back to our base, and we're going to put it in flying shape." And I said, "Well, General, I'm not worried. I think I can fly the airplane, but I can't read Japanese. I don't know how to get it started." And he said, "Donnie, you don't have to worry." He says, "There's a sergeant down there who's smarter than you are." And he said, "He'll tell you how to start the airplane. And I went down and I met Gerhard Newman, who I had not met before. And somehow German had gotten to China, and he had been made a prisoner, but he kind of got himself transferred into the American Air Force. And Gerhard Newman was one of the best scientists we had in that part of the world, and we didn't even know it. And Gerhard put the airplane together, and I flew it on its first flight, and flew beautifully. Actually, it was a beautiful flying machine, and I tested fine. Then I let it, I lowered the landing gear, and one wheel came down. And so now I have to make a decision. Do I land it on the belly, which would damage it, but not very much, or do I try and bring it in and land it on one wheel? Well, my sporting instinct, I guess, got the best of me, and I decided that I would put it in on one wheel. And I brought it in beautifully, put it down on one wheel, and it rolled until we lost flying speed. And then, of course, the wing, which wasn't supported by the landing gear, went down, touched the runway. I skidded to a stop on my wingtip, and I think it was my left landing gear. And that was how we got our first Japanese Zero. And I guess we learned a lot from it.
Let me ask a quick question. You flew a plane you'd never flown before and then landed it on wheel like it was nothing?
Yes.
That's what I thought you said. Hill said, John Alison has the greatest pure flying skill of any pilot in that theater, a touch on the controls that knew no equal. His talents were matched only by his eagerness for combat. Mr. Alison, or General Alison, I understand that you had more than one night kill. Will you tell us about that first night when you took out some enemy and broke your own plane?
Yeah. I wanted to have I too was ambitious to have victories. And the first night I was in China, the Japanese sent a raid on our base. And Tex didn't send anybody up. And I said, after it was over, and they dropped their bombs, which didn't do any damage, but they, because we were thinly settled. I said, Tex, I said, we could see him up there. Did the AVG try and get him? He said, well, John, we made several attempts, but it really was never successful. So we just let them fly at night because they don't do much damage. They drop bombs, but they didn't really hit any important targets. I said, well, if they come tomorrow, I'm going to be up there. So the next night they did come, and I was up there. And I had a wingman, Ajax Bomler, who had been an ace in the Spanish Civil War. And I put Ajax at 10,000 feet, or 9,000 feet, and I put myself at 12 because I wanted to be below the Japanese, because the only way you could identify them is there were no lights, and we didn't have any searchlights, so they just flew around in the dark. But we could see their exhaust, a little tiny exhaust, if you were down below them. So I wanted to be sure that at least Ajax was below them, or I was. And but they came. The people on the ground could hear them, and they could see the exhaust flame from the bombers. And but we couldn't see them. Ajax couldn't see them. I couldn't see them. And we pulled around. I said, "Well, we're going to miss them." And then all of a sudden, there they were. Their exhaust was just clear. And so we went in. They were sitting ducks. At night, there's not really very much you can do except run. And they couldn't outrun us. So we found them. I pulled in behind three of them. I got two of the three before I caught fire. Ajax got two of from another triad of bombers, and we had a pretty good night. And we had four airplanes falling at the same time. Then I made a connection and set another one on fire. So we had five.
I think we've gone into our time with the air show starting. I'm going to ask if you want to have to say hello or have something signed, you limit it to one. If I see that I'm getting a little tired, I'm gonna very politely try to cut things off. But Johnny, is it okay if people come up and say hi for a minute?
Oh, well certainly. And okay. I apologize for taking
no.
so long to tell.
We apologize for airplanes wanting to fly.